Good morning, everyone. I am Rohini from Government Degree College, Begumpet. I am Assistant Professor of Biotechnology. Today, I am going to deal about Mendelian genetics and the principles and mechanisms of inheritance. So, before we start with the topic, I just want to introduce to what do you mean by inheritance. Inheritance is transfer of the genetic material. Okay, the genetic information which is passed on from parents to the progeny. So, Mendelian inheritance. Laws of Mendelian inheritance basically deals with the transfer of the genetic information, whether it can be any organism, any life organism. So the passage of the genetic information from the parents to the progeny is called as inheritance. So for example, if a new baby baby is born, we try to discern its resemblances with the parents and the immediate ancestry. So there was a lot of inquisitiveness in the mankind regarding the relationships as well as the inheritance. And many scientists till 18th century, many scientists have worked extensively on the plant hybridization techniques for the principles to derive the principles and mechanism of inheritance. One of the major scientists was John Kohlreuter. Who worked on a plant called as Nicotiana, that is tobacco. Nicotiana plant. And he had done many plant hybridization experiments on these plants, and he concluded that a hybrid is derived from both the parents, and both the parents equally determine the characteristics of the Nicotiana plant, as well as the reciprocal cross is not distinguishable. And next, another important scientist called Gärtner also observed the phenomenon of dominance. Though many scientists have been working on these principles, they could not come to a conclusion, or they could not give a frame the principles of inheritance until Gregor Johann Mendel. Whom we call the father of genetics, have systematically organized the principles, experiments for the plant hybridization techniques. He is an Austrian monk who had been working for this monastery, Augustinian monastery in Austria, and he was working on a pea plant, that is garden pea, Pisum sativum. So he was the instrumental in determining the laws which lay the foundation or the classical genetics, which lay the foundation for the mechanism of inheritance of the classical genetics till today. And why did Mendel succeed whereas the other scientists could not succeed? Now we'll see what are the reasons for the success of Gregor Johann Mendel. The first important point is Mendel studied the failures of his predecessors. He studied about the failures of his predecessors, as well as he systematically chalked out plant hybridization program. And secondly, the choice of the plant. He had taken a bisexual annual plant with 7 contrasting characters. This plant was available easily in the his monastery, and he was working out on these the characters, and he had taken only one cross at a time or one character at a time. And he had a profound knowledge about mathematics, statistics, as well as breeding experiments, that is biology. And this has helped him in planning out self-pollination. He knew the techniques like self-pollination as well as cross-pollination. And he maintained separate plots for each character, as well as homozygous plants and heterozygous plants. So Mendel succeeded in his experiments because of the following reasons. First thing is, he studied the failures of his predecessors, as well as the choice of the plant which he had taken had 7 contrasting characters, and he did not study all the characters at a time. One character at a time, and a systematic planning and statistical recordings of these results. Statistical records and careful analysis of these experiments had been successful, had been the reasons for the success for framing these inheritance of traits. Okay, and coming to the plant, the garden pea, or the commonly called garden pea, or the Pisum sativum, is an annual plant which can be grown it is an annual plant so that short lifespan as well as bisexual flowers. So the advantage of having bisexual flowers is self-pollination. It is predominantly self-pollinated. At the same time, cross-pollination is also easy by the help of the technique called as emasculation. Emasculation means removal of the anthers and introducing the pollen of our choice, and then allowing the cross-fertilization of the plants. And next one is, the cross-pollinated plants were carefully covered with the separate bags, so that further any other pollen may not to avoid the chances of another pollen to fall on it and have another characters. You can look at this slide. So he had developed, after 8 years of the struggle and painstaking experiments, he could conclude to this 3 laws, and he had published this article in 1865 in the National Proceedings for the Society of Brunn. But his work was not given much recognition during that time, and until 3 scientists, 3 independently working scientists, that is Correns, De Vries and Shermack, they had again rediscovered these Mendelian principles, and posthumously Mendel was hailed as the father of genetics. Now coming to the important terminology before we start with the laws of inheritance. So the first important terminology which you need to know is, what is an allele? Allele means alternate forms of a single character, and they are present at the same locus on the homologous chromosomes. Okay, alternate forms of a single gene. For example, if you take the tall plant, the height of the plant is governed by 2 alleles, capital T and small t. Both of them are present at the same locus on the homologous chromosomes, and both govern the single character, that is height of the plant. Similarly, if you take any other contrasting character, you have yellow seed as well as the green seed. yellow and green are the two alleles of one gene character, that is seed color. Okay, now we can see on the slide the different characteristics which were studied by Mendel. And the seven contrasting characters are the seed shape, the dominant trait is the smooth, and the recessive one being the wrinkled. Seed color is yellow and the recessive trait is the green. Pod shape, inflated is the dominant trait, and wrinkled or constricted is the recessive trait. And the pod color, green is the dominant trait and yellow is the recessive trait. And flower color is purple, dominant trait is purple and the recessive trait is white. Flower position is axillary, that is on the tip, that is on the stem is the dominant character, at the tip is the recessive character. Stem length, the tall is the dominant character and the dwarf is the recessive character. Okay, now another important terminology which we need to learn is homozygous and heterozygous. So, as the word itself is telling, homo means same. So, as we have seen, each gene is governed by two alleles. Homo means the two alleles are similar, whether it is capital T or small t, or it is capital R or small r. So, homozygous means the two alleles of gene are similar. Heterozygous means the two alleles are different. Example, if the allele for height, if you are taking, it is capital T and small t, and for the shape of the seed is round. Okay, so homozygous means the two alleles are similar, but whereas the heterozygous, the genes are not, the alleles are different. The character is same, but the alleles coding for it is different. Okay, next important terminology is pure line. Pure line means it is the number of types of self-hybridization, self-hybridized plants, so that all the progeny is similar. So you get only progeny of one kind. Okay, and the next important terminology, we have studied about alleles, homozygous, heterozygous, pure line. Then we will see what do you mean by So, another important terminology is back cross, test cross and reciprocal cross. Back cross is crossing of the F1 hybrid into any parent. As the word itself is determining, back. So, whatever F1 hybrid we are getting, if we are crossing it back to any of the parent, it is called as the back cross. And test cross is F1 into homozygous recessive parent. Only homozygous recessive parent. The word itself, test. Testing means we are testing the homozygosity or heterozygosity of the plants, and reciprocal crosses means it is the cross, it is it involves two crosses for same character but reversed sex. So reciprocal cross means, for example, if you are taking a plant from stamens from one plant and ova from the other, you are in the second cross, you are determining for the same character, but the sexes are reversed. That is, you are taking the pollen from the another plant, that is a plant A. Okay, plant A and B are taken. In the first case, in the first cross, you take the ova and the pollen, and in the second case, here you take the pollen and the ova. Okay, it is only to determine to have a, to whether the plant is showing any maternal effect or not. But the pea plant which was chosen by the Mendel had not shown any of the maternal inheritance, neither blending inheritance. So these seven contrasting characters had been either dominant or recessive. So now coming to the first one, first law of inheritance, that is law of dominance. So according to law of dominance, when two contrasting characters are taken together in a F1 hybrid, the character which appears in the F1 hybrid is called as dominant character. For example, we'll explain this with the help of a character, that is height of the stem. Two alleles are there. Alleles, as I have told you, it is only two, that is alternate forms of a single gene. It can be either a tall plant or a dwarf plant. So you always resemble the gene with the uppercase letter and recessive one with the lowercase. Okay. Now if you take these two parents and two contrasting characters are brought together in F1 hybrid, homozygous tall plant is crossed with homozygous dwarf plant. So you get gametes out of that, capital T, small t, small t. Okay, this is a possible type of gam. So capital T and small t is your F1 hybrid. F1 hybrid means first filial generation. Filial means progeny. Is it clear? So I would like to explain the law of dominance again. So when a pair of contrasting characters are brought together in a F1 hybrid, the character which is appearing in the F1 hybrid is called as the dominant character, and the character which is not appearing in the F1 and appearing in the F2 is called as the recessive character. This is heterozygous tall plant. So though it is heterozygous, the plant height will be similar to that of your parent plant, that is tall homozygous. It is around 7 feet height. This gene is functional. That is why the tall plant is tall, because of the gene responsible for that. At LE locus, it is encoding beta hydroxylase gene, which converts the GA1 to GA20. So because of this conversion, that is presence of functional gene is causing the tall plant to be tall. But whereas in the dwarf plant, this is mutated or it is producing non-functional polypeptides, and the absence of these is that is why the dwarf plant is dwarf. It is around 1 feet height, whereas the tall plant is around 7 feet height. Okay. Now we'll see, when this F1 hybrid is self-crossed, what are the results for the F2 generation? Okay. When you draw a checkerboard, this is the F1 hybrid, this is upon selfing F1. So when you self the F1 hybrid, you get the following results. So phenotypic ratio is, what is phenotypic ratio? The physical appearance of the plant, okay, the, based on the physical characteristics, whatever you determine, it is called as the phenotypic ratio. That is, 3 tall plants is to 1 dwarf plant. Okay, next, what is the genotypic ratio? The genotypic ratio means the genetic makeup of the plant. That is 1 capital T capital T and 2 capital T small t and 1 small t small t. So this is the genetic makeup of the plant. So phenotypic characters is physical characters, genotype is the genetic makeup of the plant. Is this clear? Now we'll go to the next law, that is law of segregation or law of purity of gametes. So, law of segregation or law of purity of gametes says that when two contrasting characters are brought together in a F1 hybrid, the two alleles of the contrast or the contrasting genes remain together in the F1, and then next without contaminating or having any interaction with each other, and in the next generation they form equal number of gametes. And whatever, how many number of dominant gametes are formed, that many recessive gametes are also formed. There is no interaction between the two genes, as well as equal number of gametes are formed in both the character. Okay. So, law of segregation or law of purity of gametes means the, when two contrasting characters are brought together in a F1 hybrid, the two characters remain together in pure form. And in the next generation, they separate out equally. So, the separation is independent and equal number of dominant as well as the recessive gametes are formed. And similar kinds of results are observed. So, not only this experiment you can take, the another characters what you can take is round and yellow color seed also. So, three genotypes yield 2 kinds of phenotypes. And next one is law of independent assortment. So the law of purity of gametes and law of dominance can be explained with the help of monohybrid cross. Now the third law is law of independent assortment. So according to law of independent assortment, when two or more contrasting characters are brought together in a F1 hybrid, the characters separate out or assort out independent of the another. So we can explain this law with the help of a dihybrid cross. Dihybrid cross is a cross involving two characters at a time. So here we are taking two characters, that is shape of the seed and second gene. Because it is dihybrid cross, means two characters. First one is shape of the seed and second one is color of the seed. Okay, this is again having two alleles, isn't it? Alternate forms, that is round and wrinkled. As you know, it is always uppercase of the dominant character. It is resembled by capital R and wrinkled means small r. Color of the seed is yellow. One of the allele, dominant allele is capital Y and capital Y, and the recessive allele is green, that is small y and small y. Okay, these are the two alleles of the shape of the seed and color of the seed. Is it clear? Now we'll do the cross. So, parents. This is homozygous, round and yellow seeds. This is homozygous, wrinkled and green seeds. Okay, now this parental combination will produce gametes. Gametes have half the number of chromosomes. So it is capital R and capital Y from this plant and small r and small y from this plant. So when they are cross, this is cross pollination, capital R and small r, capital Y and small y. This is your F1 hybrid. F1 hybrid having round seeds and yellow seeds, but it is not homozygous, it is heterozygous. So upon selfing this one, whenever you get, then we will see the F2 generation. So when you have crossed the round, homozygous round and yellow seeds with wrinkled and green seeds, in the F1 generation you are obtaining a F1 hybrid containing round and yellow seeds. This is because of the dominant gene present here, that is capital R as well as capital Y. They are because of the presence of the starch branching enzyme, which is giving the round shape to the seed. Okay, and because these genes are getting expressed, the characters, though it is present in single dose, the gene or the character is getting expressed. Now we'll see the F2 generation. Okay, so the possible number of gametes out of this capital R and capital Y, capital R and small y, okay, small r capital Y and small r and small y. So these are the four number of possible gametic combinations which are obtaining from the F1 hybrid. Okay, now this is what the law of independent assortment states. The dominant allele is independently pairing with the another dominant allele as well as the recessive allele. Similarly, the recessive allele of one character is equally pairing with the dominant allele of the another character as well as the recessive character. So all the number of all the possible gametic combinations are possible in equal combinations.
So, yeah, I'll explain.
So whatever gametic combinations we obtained in the F1 hybrid, so according to law of independent assortment, equal number of gametes are taken from the female plant as well as the equal number of gametes are taken from the male plant. And when you have to draw the checkerboard like this. So this is a checkerboard wherein gametic combinations are only half of the number of the actual diploid state. So capital R, capital R, capital Y, capital Y. So now this is two combinations I have drawn, and you can see the characteristic. I have also written the what the phenotypic character also determines. Okay. Now, even though the character is small r over here, we are always supposed to start with capital R. That is, a dominant allele should be written whatever may be the order. Okay. So, capital Y, capital Y. It determines round and yellow seeds. Okay. So, as you can observe in this one, whether it is the capital R gene is present in a single dose or in a double dose, the character is always round. Why? Because the gene responsible for the starch branching enzyme, it is giving the smooth shape for that one, and that is why it is round. But whereas any mutations in this form, it will not have, it will not show the proper smoothness, and it appears a wrinkled. It gives a wrinkled look. So here, capital R, small r, capital Y, small y. Okay, capital R, small r, capital Y, small y. So this is again round and yellow. Okay, now here it is small r and capital Y. That means small r means there is no gene for round seed. It is wrinkled and yellow. Is it clear? Next, last one, this one in this box is small r, capital Y, small y. That is wrinkled and yellow. This is again round and yellow, because it is at least having one dominant gene over here. So that is why the gene is getting expressed. In the next one, again it is capital R and small r and small y and small y. That is round and green. And next one is small r, capital Y and small y. This is again wrinkled and yellow. And the last one is homozygous for all the recessive ones, that is wrinkled and green. So we, according to law of independent assortment, we said that when two or more contrasting characters are coming in together in a F1 hybrid, that the characters assort out independent of the another. So a dominant allele equally pairs with another character, dominant allele, as well as a recessive allele. Similarly, a recessive allele equally pairs with a another dominant allele as well as a recessive allele. And this is the F2 generation. We are getting 16 plants, and in this one we are seeing how it how many number of characters are there. So if we determine the phenotypic or the physical characters, phenotypic ratio, that is 9:3:1 is the typical Mendelian dihybrid ratio. What is this 9? 9 is round and yellow. What is this 3? Round and green. Then wrinkled yellow. And the last one is wrinkled green. Is it clear? So when we have self-crossed the F1 hybrid of the round homozygous round and the homozygous yellow wrinkled green plant in the F2 generation, we are obtaining a phenotypic ratio of 9:3:3:1. Okay. So the phenotypic ratio obtained is 9 round and yellow plants. When you count this checkerboard, you can find round yellow plants, that is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 and 9. So there are 9 round and yellow plants irrespective of homozygous or heterozygosity. Then 3 round and green plants, that is 1, 2 over here and third one over here. Okay, phenotypic ratio. Genotypic ratio is nothing but the genetic makeup of the plant. So it is very, one of the easy technique to find out is, we already know that 9 are round and yellow. The gametic combinations of this is capital R, capital Y, capital R, capital Y, capital R, capital R, capital Y, small y, then capital R, small y, capital Y, small y. So these are the combinations what you have got out of the 9 round and yellow. This is 1. When you look at the board, it is 1. This is 2 combinations. Okay. Here as well as here. 2 and this is 4. So total 9. Next, capital R, small r, capital Y, small y. Two, and this is 2. Then this is the genotypic ratio. So when you have seen the 9:3:1, so we have, I have divided this into 9:3:1. So this is 9 plants which are round and yellow. Okay, these are the 3 plants which are round and green. And these are the 3 plants which are wrinkled and yellow. And the last one is your wrinkled green. So the genotypic ratio is 1:2:2:4:1:2:1:1. So when you count, it is 16 plants. So the I have segregated this into based on the phenotypic characters. Out of these 9 plants, what is the variation? First, I have changed only, I have written all the homozygous, then I have taken one recessive allele, and then next one recessive for the another allele, then recessive character for both. Okay, similarly I have done that one. So this is an easier method to write the genotypic ratios. So first you identify what are the phenotypic ratio, then based on that one you can easily determine the genotypic ratios. Is it clear? So today we have discussed about the laws of Mendelian laws of inheritance. In this one we have first studied about law of dominance, next we have studied about law of segregation, then law of independent assortment. There are again deviations. When you can see this one with a checkerboard, you can see the dihybrid cross, that is round yellow and as well as the green wrinkled and so on with the shapes on the screen. Okay, then there are again deviations from the Mendelian laws, or this is the Mendelian laws are not followed by certain plants. Here in this one we can see this is called as incomplete dominance. Incomplete dominance, this is the first deviation from the Mendelian inheritance. So in a plant, example is a plant called 4 o'clock plant. It is called 4 o'clock plant because it will bloom late in the afternoon, and it is, the scientific name is Mirabilis jalapa. So when you look at the screen, you have two different characters, that is a red color flower and a white color flower. The capital R is a dominant gene and the white color is a recessive character. When there is a cross between these two plants, there is blending, or the F1 hybrid is the intermediate between the two parent plants. So when a red color plant is crossed with a white colored plant, the character what you got in the F1 hybrid is pink color flowers. So there is gene interaction. In case of the law of dominance, we did not observe this character. Whatever gene was the character of the dominant gene was getting expressed. But in case of incomplete dominance, the two genes which are coding for the color are not dominant. So they are incompletely dominant. Hence there is blending. Hence this incomplete dominance is also called as blending inheritance. Hence there is interaction. That is, it is not following law of segregation or purity of gametes. When the F1, when the two contrasting characters are bought, they are interacting and an intermediate color is getting produced, that is pink color. Okay, and whenever you you can see in the on the board, it is the F2 generation also is having same genotypic characters as well as the phenotypic characters, that is one red flower, two pink flowers and one white color flowers. Another last example is codominance. Okay, this is also a deviation from the Mendelian inheritance in which both the genes are getting expressed. The example is your blood group system. See, if the RBC is having the proteins for this phenotypic characters, antibodies for the A, antigens of the A, it is producing A. Okay. It codes for IAIA, codes for A positive blood group. IBIB codes for B positive, as well as IA and IB. That is, both the characters are getting equally expressed. That is AB positive. So you cannot classify them as neither dominant or recessive. So another example, last example you can see is the shorthorn cattle, wherein the red color and the white color were crossed, you got a roan color that is having both the combinations, that is red spots as well as white spots. So this is, these are the two laws which are not following the Mendelian principles. Okay, there are many other genetic interactions. Okay, thank you one and all for giving me this opportunity, especially the Commissioner of Collegiate Education for giving me this opportunity to deliver this lecture. Thank you.